So hi, hello and welcome. Microbe Hunter here. And I was recently asked whether there are also actually microscopic animals. And I was a little bit surprised by the question and I asked, what do you mean? Microscopic animals? Of course, there are many microscopic animals. And then he asked me, well, I mean, real animals, not just microorganisms like the single-celled paramecia or the amoeba, the protists. But are there real animals that are too small to be seen with the unaided eye? And I said, that is a great question. For this reason, I'm going to show you today some of the more interesting and fascinating microscopic animals that you are able to find in nature and in the environment. So let's have a look at our first specimen. This is a so-called gastrotrich, also known as a hairy belly. I guess you've never heard this word before. Well, these are small, tiny water animals that can be found living on the bottom of a pond. Many of them are freshwater animals. Some of them are also saltwater animals. There are approximately 800 different species of them, but I think there must be many, many more of them. Those gastrotrichs, as you can see here, are a little bit difficult to follow around because they move so quickly under the microscope. They have hair that they are beating, the so-called cilia. This causes them to move forward, but they also have certain adhesive glands that allow them to attach themselves to surfaces and to stick to surfaces. They have a simple nervous system, they have a simple reproductive system, and they also have, of course, the possibility to ingest food over a trunk, and then they expel it again if the parts that are not digested. Now, I think that those gastrotrichs are quite fascinating animals, also because they are so-called eutelic. This means eutelic is the concept that the number of cells, the body cells that they have, is fixed. So all members of the same species have the same number of body cells. And this is, of course, a very interesting fact because it allows you then to trace back the origin of the individual cells. The next specimen, these are crustaceans. Crustaceans are arthropods, and they're related to the shrimps, to the crabs, and so on. These crustaceans here, sometimes they're generally referred to as water fleas, but that is a very, very diverse term. This one over here is called cyclops. And what you have here is that they are found in a free water sample. So when you scoop up a cup full of pond water, then you're able to find those swimming around, eating and feeding on bacteria and other small microscopic debris. So in other words, they keep the water clean. They can be, some of them can be quite large, maybe a millimeter or even 2 millimeters in diameter. Some others can be quite small. And if you're lucky, you're able to find also a few of them that crawl along this long string of algae. Because they are moving around so quickly, of course, they need a lot of energy and therefore they need a high amount of oxygen as well. And for this reason, they can be found especially in very clean water, which is quite rich in oxygen. Now, the total number of species of those crustaceans, well, I have to tell you, there must be a lot of them. You might not know what this is, but this actually is a rotifer emerging. So a rotifer, that's the next type of micro animal. Rotifers are also known as wheeled animals. And in this case, one of them is now emerging out and you have to wait a few minutes. So a little bit of time lapse will actually speed it up. And those rotifers, they were actually already discovered in the 17th century. And the people who saw them first were already describing quite accurately how they're able to move. Some of those rotifers are able to move like an inchworm. They're able to stick to surface and then they move forward, while others are able to move around by their so-called corona. And the corona, this is actually the part of the rotifer which has a ring of cilia which is beating. And those ring of cilia, what they're doing is they're also collecting the food, and then the food, usually small bacteria and other cellular debris, is sucked in for further digestion. Yeah, so here you have one, as you see how it's attached to a surface on one side, and then there are others like this one over here, where you can see the corona, which is the ring of cilia that it has. And that's why they're called wheeled animals, because the ring of cilia looks like a spinning wheel under the microscope. And sometimes what happens is that if they touch an object and to protect themselves, they quickly retract and pull backwards. that's basically what they like to do. Those rotifers, actually, I have to tell you, are so common and ubiquitous that I think I'm a little bit disappointed when I see them because, yeah, I've seen them already in so many water samples. So all you do is you take a small piece of decaying leaf material and you put it under the microscope. Chances are very good that you're able to see them. This here is quite fascinating. Those things that are floating around, swimming around, these are in many cases ciliates, and they're single cells. So you see that the rotifer, which contains approximately 1,000 cells, is not that much larger. It is larger, but not that much larger than those single-celled protozoa that you see swimming around here. Yeah, and here again, there are two of them next to each other. And this one is a type which kind of moves forward like an inchworm, while others, again, they like to swim freely, and then they connect themselves again to a surface. Yeah, so they're, yeah, it's also here quite a diverse group. Well, this is a nematode. A nematode are also known as the roundworms, and they are extremely diverse. Here, this is a microscopic nematode and not moving so quickly. This one, it's just now moving along inside some decaying material. And those nematode worms are so ubiquitous and so common that if you were to remove all of the things on this planet except the worms, then you're still able to see the outline of the continents. That's not what I'm inventing, but that's a common knowledge, so to say, among those people who are studying nematodes. Now, some nematodes are moving a little bit slowly, like this one here, a little bit almost like in a snake-like manner. And other nematodes are moving very erratically. I'm going to show you. Yeah, here we go. That's also something that I found on a decaying piece of wood. Yeah, they were moving and flexing themselves and moving around very erratically, never coming to a rest, which also makes it a little bit difficult to observe. But when you zoom in, then you can actually see also that they have internal organs. And I think you have already guessed, they need a lot of energy being so active. What they do is they decompose material. And what I assume what they also do is that they also, of course, release enzymes that digest the material and then they reabsorb it. There are many types of worms. This one here is a flatworm, and it's again different. And those flatworms, what they have is they have also a pharynx, which is a trunk-like structure and which acts like a mouth. And they are able to then suck in food that they want to eat, and then they digest it and they spit out the rest. Now, watch here. Just in a second, I'm going to show you because this flatworm over here is now going to eat Have you seen this? Yeah, that was basically a little rotifer that it has swallowed and it spat it out again. Apparently, it didn't like the taste of it. Yeah, but it is something that you can see every now and then under the microscope, that you see organisms being eaten and being digested, spat out again, and so on. It's always something going on. Some of those flatworms are pretty aggressive. I mean, they like to take bites out of other organisms as well. So they are pretty aggressive hunters as well. You know, some of them are too big to be eaten, and I've also seen that some of those flatworms try to eat an object that's far too large. We're still staying with the worms here. This one here is so-called an oligoheat worm or an annelid. These are the segmented worms, and they have a very typical characteristic, not only that they're quite large, but if you look carefully, they have bristles on the side. Sometimes you're able to see them better than in other times, but there are little hair that are sticking out on the side of this worm, and they're using those hairs also to move forward. So they're not only contract their muscles to move forward, but they also extend the hair, and those little hair, those bristles, they anchor the worm on a surface and allows it to move forward a little bit more easily. Just in a few minutes, I'm going to show you actually a high magnification of those bristles as they're being extended and again withdrawn. But first of all, let's have a closer look. Here too, we have a digestive system, and those worms, they have a mouth and an anus, so they're eating something through the mouth, it's digested, and then the undigestible material is expelled again. And this is something that you're also able to see under the microscope, because those microscopic animals, they are quite transparent. And here, this is what I promised you, look very carefully. Okay, there are those paramecia, single-celled organisms on the side, but maybe you can see that sometimes it extends those hair outwards, and this causes them the organism to be anchored in the ground, and it allows it to move forward more easily. Yeah, so there are those little hair, which are able to be extended by the use of muscles. And this is a typical characteristic of this group of organisms. And here now my favorite one, everyone's favorite, everyone's darling, the water bear, of course. Not a bear, and also called moss piglet, also not a pig, but yeah, an own group of animals. They have 8 legs and can be found, as the name says, on moss. So if you have a moss sample and if you keep it wet, and then you're able to rinse it out, and this is what you're able to see. They are quite well known because they're extremely resilient. This means is they can survive dryness. They can also survive high radiation. And maybe some of you already know, they have also been sent to space for experimentation, and they could be returned as well, and they were able to survive this. I've also seen this under the microscope, where some of those that dried up, when you add water again, they come back to life. Yeah, they are very favorite organisms because they look kind of cute, and they too are quite interesting to study, especially when you want to observe and investigate how is stress resistance and dry resistance, how do organisms manage that. So these are the specimens of choice here. Well, I've given you now an overview over some of the more common true water animals, microscopic animals, that you can find. There are many more that I did not talk about, for example, microscopic mites, for example, they are also quite fascinating, but maybe I'll leave this up to a different video. In any case, I wish you all the best. Please subscribe to the channel if you like these type of videos and click the notification bell. Happy microbe hunting as always, and see you around next time. Bye-bye.